Bob Berson. What can you say about Bob Berson? Well, Bob certainly is leader of the Northern Westchester Society. He's also a therapist. He is a graduate of the Fieldston School, of the Ethical Culture Schools, and of the Sunday School of the Riverdale Yonkers Society. He graduated from Haverford College and earned graduate degrees at Harvard University, Bank Street College of Education, Teachers College, and City University of New York. He taught ethics in the ethics department at Fieldston. So I think he's somebody we would call a cradle ethical culture. Because I think a lot of us come to it later in life, we check different things out. But if you were someone who were born to it, you went to the schools, you taught. He was dean of the National Leaders Council for a number of years, which is sort of our version of our personal pastor. And so here's my personal pastor, Bob Berson.
And could also have said that I'm a homegrown product, which might make me a turkey. So I'm not sure how to deal with that. I do want to say, though, that it's a pleasure to be at the New York Society for Ethical Culture. It always is. It was a special treat to know that Anne was going to be presiding when I came. But I will say that the great moment was walking into this building and being greeted by hundreds of voices telling me how great thou art. What I usually get is, not bad, occasionally pretty good, but you know, that's about as far as we go. So thank you all for your wonderful welcome. I will try to live up to something. I wanted to begin with a quick word from a woman we all know and love. We may have a crush on her, Emily Dickinson. If I can stop one heart from breaking, I shall not live in vain. If I can ease one life the aching, or cool one pain, or help one fainting robin unto his nest again, I shall not live in vain. We can probably go home now, she's said, but I won't let you. I did promise to explain the title, Ethics and the Emotions, one under the case of compassion, because last year, I did three addresses. The second was on ethics and the emotions, the evolution, child development, and neuroscience of compassion. And I ended with the third, which was on compassion and citizenship. So that's the reason for the confusing one in the title, but I thought it would be fun. Let me begin with two stories, and I'll weave these stories through the morning. On the way to Troy, as we are told by Sophocles, the great Greek archer Philoctetus stepped by accident on holy ground and was bitten by a snake. The ground was sacred to a god, and the serpent was protecting the holy ground. The wound was putrid. It oozed smelly pusses. The pain was constant, with surges of excruciating agony, and nothing could cure it. Philoctetus continually cried out. He uttered all sorts of blasphemies, which made it impossible for the other Greek soldiers to pursue their religious rituals. That endangered them all on the way to Troy. So the Greek leaders abandoned Philoctetus on an uninhabited island where he lived in a cave in constant pain. 10 years later, the Greeks returned, the Trojan War still going on. They had heard a prophecy that they would not be able to defeat Troy without Philoctetus and his magic bow and arrows. The wily Odysseus, remember the wily Odysseus? We all read the Odyssey in length of 10th grade. The wily Odysseus, I see some heads nodding. The wily Odysseus planned to trick Philoctetus, who was understandably resentful, into giving up the magic bow and arrows. And he got a good young soldier named Neoptolemus to carry out the plot. Before even seeing Philoctetus, the chorus, Greek chorus, speaks. Wait. Before I let the chorus speak, second story. Recently, a baby was born with congenital heart defects. He looked healthy, but a routine post-birth examination detected a heart murmur. And so began a series of visits to pediatric cardiologists. For short periods of time, the child was, like for the fetus, abandoned to force feedings of the barrier for x-rays, to blood drawings to see what was going on in the blood and stream, for ultrasounds and all sorts of other medical procedures, some of which were painful, and all of which separated him from family. There was reconstructive open heart surgery at 20 months of age. Recovering in the hospital at that point, one day, the chief resident, followed by all the younger residents, marched into the patient's room like the Muppets, but not as cheerful. And the baby, who had, for some reason, developed a name for his father, which was Bobby Bob, said, as a 20-month-old child says, looking at the doctors who were coming in, "Bobby Bob, no more pain, please." What do we feel when we hear those two stories? We may have felt disgust at the image of a smelly, putrid, oozing room. We may, some of us, the bigger they are, the nurse once said to me, the harder they fall, may have felt queasy and dizzy at the thought of blood tests. We also might have experienced emotions that we could call pity or empathy or sympathy or compassion. Are such feelings natural, reasonable, rational? Are they important for an ethical life, for a good life, for a good society? Coming back to Philoctetus, the Greek chorus speaks. Remember, the chorus always speaks in the first person singular, even though there may be many of them. The chorus says, "For my part, I have compassion for him. Think how, with no human company or care, no sight of a friendly face, wretched, always alone, he wastes away with that savage disease, with no way of meeting his daily needs. How in the world does the poor man survive?" The chorus of soldiers imagines, note that word, the chorus of soldiers imagines a man they have never met, never seen. They conceive of his situation, and they say they feel compassion. Let me offer some rough-hewn definitions. The terms are often used overlappingly, sometimes synonymously, but they do have slightly different connotations. I'll begin with pity, which has a noble history. Pity was used in the way we now use compassion, but it's come to have in current language a kind of condescending tone, which is too bad, and so I won't use it. Let's talk about empathy. Empathy is an emotional response which is identical or very close to the feeling of another person, and yet we have an awareness that it's the other person's emotion. It's not what naturalists call emotional contagion. A flock of birds is startled by a cat. They're not imagining each other's feelings. They're all catching the fearful movement of the first bird who sees the cat. Sympathy is a little different. Sympathy is an emotional recognition, a response of sorrow or concern at the condition of another person. And sometimes, but not necessarily, has empathy in it. Sympathy can come from an intellectual assessment. One can easily say, "I can't imagine how that person feels, but I do feel concern for his or her plight." Empathy, in a sense, resonates with the feelings of another. Sympathy focuses on the situation of another. Now, we can both sympathize with Philoctetus because of his terrible situation, which we understand intellectually, and we can empathize with him by imagining that word again. Imagining and feeling what he must have felt, abandoned, isolated, in pain. We can sympathize with the toddler and the toddler's parents in that toddler's awful situation, pain, periods of forced separation from his parents. And we can also empathize with his fear and sadness. These stories already tell us much about how much of our emotions is about relationship, connection, concern, and care, even to people, real or imagined, fiction, but we have never met, might never know. Compassion, has been said, is a sometimes painful emotion occasioned by the awareness of another person's undeserved misfortune with a motivational disposition to attend and to respond with care. Awareness, compassion, that's a thoughtful, not mere feeling kind of experience. A major point, which is made by philosopher Martha Nussbaum, is that compassion emphasizes the functional and adaptive role of the emotion. She makes the point that all of our emotions are adaptive, they're functional. Emotions have an evaluative content. Most of us don't really think about that kind of judgment. Nussbaum sees emotions as the title of the book, which I brought with me, it's a weightlifting practice, 700 pages long. Nussbaum sees emotions as eruptions of thought. And I am indebted to Martha Nussbaum for giving me that book to practice weightlifting and also read. Well, what does Nussbaum mean by the thoughtfulness of emotions? As I said, emotions are evaluative. They're about what we need to flourish. Dealing with something like simple survival, which is rather important. I can't function if I'm not surviving. To more distinctive conceptions of what it means to be human. It's not simply survival that she talks about. And it's not simply happiness, but it's human flourishing. In the sense of the ancient Greek word eudaimonia, which is a life which is flourishing by being a good life, a worthwhile life, and a satisfying life. Let me give some rough examples. If we feel the emotion of fear, it's because that predator out in the hall is going to gobble me up. And if I get gobbled up, I won't be able to function. It's rather valuable to me. I'm judging my survival more important than the tiger's appetite, and I'm going to run. Of course, you all know the famous story about the two hunters in the Catskills who are being chased by a bear. One of them says, "Boy, I sure hope we can outrun that bear." The other one says, "I just hope I can outrun you." We may feel happiness at the success of a friend. He passed his doctoral exam or something. There's a judgment there. It's a good thing we evaluate happy because of something. We're not just catching happiness. We might feel disgust at that rotting, putrefying meat that is sitting in front of us. Evolutionarily, that's a very good emotion to have, that putrefying meat might poison us. We might sublimate that, right, Cynthia, and talk about disgust at a more human level, more abstract level, disgust at the corruption of political life, disgust at the sexual abuse of children. That might even lead to another emotion, moral indignation. If we experience the emotion of grief, it's about the loss of someone we love, we care about, we value, someone who really matters to us, someone who is unique, irreplaceable, and irretrievably gone. When we love, it's for a particular person. We evaluate that person as being of infinite importance to us. No one else like him or her. And yet, that person is irretrievably gone. Again, Nussbaum says there are these evaluative contents of all emotions. And the cognitive evaluative content of compassion, suggests Nussbaum, involves three major parts, and I apologize to Martha Nussbaum for oversimplifying drastically. First, when we feel compassion, we are judging the seriousness of the misfortune suffered by someone else. There is some damage, for example, minor damage to a, quote, worthless pickup truck of a working person is more serious than a scratch on the luxury vehicle of someone rich. We judge that that loss is very significant, and the scratch much less so. Poverty, pain, illness, loss of loved ones, loss of freedom, loneliness, we judge those to be, and so does Aristotle, very serious misfortune. misfortune. We judge seriousness. We also judge, we evaluate deservedness. A person who causes his or her own misfortune, we tend to blame and we want that person to take some responsibility. But even if someone has caused some personal misfortune, we can also feel compassion at some undeserved punishment or situation that ensues. The child may break a rule in a classroom, but if that child is forced to stand in front of the class in shame for hours, we feel compassion for that child. Third, we recognize in compassion that similar situations can occur to us or to people we know and love. We too could be victims of or suffer from illness, the deaths of friends or family, the destruction of homes or businesses. And finally, Nussbaum suggests that when we feel compassion, we are saying, in some sense, that person or those people matter to us. Their well-being affects our sense of well-being. So let me return to my two stories. Remember, the wily Odysseus had convinced Neoptolemus to get the bow of Philoctetus by deceit and then abandon Philoctetus yet again. But just as Philoctetus hands the bow over, he experiences a blinding attack of pain. He cries out. He wishes for his own death rather than continue to bear the undeserved pain. And Neoptolemus, up to now, a co-conspirator with Odysseus, says, I have been in pain for you. I have long been in sorrow for your pain. Statement of compassion. And interestingly, Philoctetus responds, no boy, keep up your heart. It, that is the pain, it is quick in coming and quick to go. Only I entreat you, do not leave me alone. And Neoptolemus responds, do not be afraid. We shall stay. Notice that it's not only the physical pain that elicits compassion, but the social pain of unutterably lonely isolation from human companionship. And note the reciprocity of concern for Lachitas, for Neoptolemus, as well as the other way. Leaving the abandoned island, we come back. Tragedy takes place, remember Aristotle said, in one place and in one time frame. But the little boy's life is more like a movie. There are different scenes. We begin with the anxious parents needing to know what's going on with their 10-month-old son before the surgeons are going to chop him up. A young cardiac fellow in cardiology, a young woman, met them pacing in the hall late at night, realized their distress, took them into an empty room and spent 2 or 3 hours drawing anatomical charts and explaining the nature of the surgery. She didn't leave until 2 or 3 in the morning. She probably started at 6 the previous morning. Think of the father before the surgery, holding the little boy to his chest, feeling their two hearts beating, and thinking of his son's fear, pain, separation, and thinking, he wished he could exchange hearts with the little boy, take the bad heart into his chest, and have a surgery done to him. Empathy, compassion, a little magical thinking. And then think of the father's next response, which was abject terror at the thought of being in the hospital room, having the surgery done to himself. What's called distress, to which I'll return. Think of the little boy then, now 14 or 15, going to another cardiologist. Coming out of the examination room, the cardiologist says to the father, he asked a question I'd like to share with you. The 14-year-old, very upset. The question was, what's my life expectancy going to be? Why was the boy so angry? He said, well, it's confidential, but it wasn't that. The boy didn't want the parents to know that he was worried that they're worried. Worry about his concern, about his life expectancy. Later yet, just after college, and after several more procedures, including the insertion of a pacemaker, boy said to his parents he would never get married nor have children because he wouldn't want to leave a widow, he wouldn't want to leave children without a father. Once again, compassion for people he did not know, compassion for people in the future that he was experiencing. And some years later, another procedure in a distant city, the father said, would you like me to come and be with you during this procedure? The son said, no, I've been through this stuff before, but I've got a new girlfriend. She's never been through this stuff with me before. Maybe you can come to help her. And most of us would say, well, the kid really wanted the father to come, right? He's just using his girlfriend as an excuse. But after the procedure, the girlfriend thanked the father, said how glad she was to come, said she did not think she could have gone through it without the father's company. And when the father said to her, well, he told me to come for you, her response was, he's the most considerate man I've ever met. Considerate in the sense, compassion. I'm going to skip some comments about research at this point, but talk about a little bit the development of compassion. Infants cry at the cries of others. Toddlers will bring toys to other toddlers who are crying in the nursery. Wow. An 11-year-old boy that I know at a summer camp saw a kid sniffling as visiting day was ending, and the other kid's mother was leaving. And this 11-year-old boy goes up to the other kid's mother, hugs her, and says, don't worry, I'll take care of him. 11 years old. I want to read a passage from Robert Coles talking about a 14-year-old boy in the South, white boy. School is just integrated. He doesn't want all these federal judges and intervening Northerners pushing black kids on his class. Then he sees a black kid being surrounded by members of his own white basketball team. That's threatening. And the white boy says to stop it. He says later to Dr. Coles, I don't know what happened to me that moment, but it changed my life. The moment of compassion changed his life. Compassion and its empathic base are wonderful, but it hurts sometimes. If we feel compassion, in part because we recognize the possible similarities in our lives to those who suffer, we may really want to distance ourselves from that. It's known as empathic distress. Ezra Stotland did research with student nurses. The most compassionate student nurses in their first year spent the least amount of time with their patients. How interesting. Well, it hurt too much. With good supervision, I should say, with compassionate supervision, by the end of that first year training, they spent the most time with their patients. Education can help. Indeed, fiction can help. Reading stories. I advise you, however, to say to your children, not how would you feel in that situation, which engenders empathic distress, but how do you imagine that other person might feel if they were in that situation? Fiction can do that too. And there are some studies about the use of such techniques in schools. I just turn to my educated friends. But I won't get into that research now. That's ethics of emotion, too. I think I've alluded earlier to compassion being not just an interpersonal phenomenon, but also an experience of importance to our vision of community, society, national and international vision and purpose. How do we feel in response to our fellow human beings, poverty, illness, ignorance, despair, hunger? How do we apply those feelings to public policy, healthcare, education, taxation? For example, with regard to the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, known as SNAP or food stamps, Paul Krugman wrote a column and quoted a Republican congressional representative named Stephen Fincher from Tennessee. Fincher read from the New Testament, quote, the one who is unwilling to work shall not eat. Is that a failure of imagination, of empathy, of compassion? It's a statement which elicited from me, and maybe from others of you, a feeling of disgust, especially after I read that Representative Fincher has received millions of dollars in farm subsidies from the government of the United States. Farm subsidies for not growing food. But let me begin to conclude. As Ann knows, when I begin to conclude, there's a lot more to go. But I beg your forgiveness in advance. Martha Nussbaum reminds us of the importance of reciprocity in relationships of compassion. And I think I've indicated in both the old story and the new, the reciprocity of compassion. Nussbaum reminds us of the importance of recognizing individuality in relationships, uniqueness. And she urges that empathy leading to compassion should also lead to action in the world. Sounds like ethical culture, doesn't it? In ethical culture, we emphasize the unique, distinctive, individual worth of every human being. We emphasize the reciprocity of all relationships, saying that the maxim we should live by is that altogether now acts and is lived to elicit the best in others, and thereby in yourself. We know that our part of the world is to do what we can to make the world a little better. Remember what Emily Dickinson said? Put a sparrow back in its nest. A small act of peace makes the universe better. We recognize that we have to respond always to the work and the suffering of unique individual others. Our part is to recognize the worth in others, even if it's hidden in a latent state, and then we should seek it out, elicit it, allow it to flourish. Our part is to know we're all different, unique, irreplaceable, and yet also all similar. The joys and sorrows are part of being human. Our part is to address the problems in our lives and in our world by using humanity's best, perhaps only, tools, our compassion and our intelligence. Ah, but the stories, I haven't come to the end, have I? David, would you like a coda? It's a musical term. Neoptolemus rejected the deceitful position of Odysseus, and he returned to the bow of Philoctetus. But now remember, this is a Greek tragedy, it's Sophocles, it's not David Mamet's play. Neoptolemus also chastises Philoctetus for his unabated anger. He says it's time to give up resentment. This degree of anger, desire for revenge, is not good either. And Neoptolemus tells of another prophecy. There's always a good prophecy in a tragedy, right? Prophecy is that if Philoctetus comes to Troy with the Greeks, he will be healed of his wound and become a leader of the victorious Greek army. And then, the immortal Heracles descends from heaven. And Heracles confirms the prophecy, convinces Philoctetus, and Philoctetus chooses to rejoin the Greeks, go to Troy, fight, and return eventually a hero. A happy ending. It's an unusual tragedy in the Greek tragic tradition. It's worth reading and comparing to other tragedies. It is unusual. Oh, and the boy. Oh. The boy is now a young man in his mid-30s. Can't talk about a happy ending because judge man no happy until he is dead. Which Greek philosopher said that? Can't judge a life until it's over. But nonetheless, there's a new and happy act, if not seen, occurring in this story. Last fall, the girl whom I mentioned became his wife. And about 2 weeks ago, she gave birth to their first child. Now, I should end by saying, to be fully transparent, I did not know Philoctetus. But I do know the boy